everyone. Welcome to the one more video session of ARM. This is Vasant Naik from Canara Engineering College. Students, in this video, you will be going to study CPSR. In my previous video, I have given an introduction to the CPSR. CPSR means Current Program Status Register. Current Program Status Register. Actually, it is a flag register. So, in this video, I will explain you what is a CPSR. CPSR is a 32-bit register. It resides in the registry file. So CPSR, a 32-bit register can, 32-bit register is divided into actually four fields. One is a flag field, second one is a status field, extension field and control field of 8 bits. Out of this, status field and extension fields are reserved. And control field gives information about operating modes of your processor. Then type of interrupt, fast interrupt, whether the processor is there in the fast interrupt mode or normal interrupt mode, whether the processor is using thumb instruction or normal instruction, all this information it will give. Other than that, we have something called as a flag register, which contains various flags. So here there are different types of flags. You can see N, Z, C, V, Q, J. Now N means negative flag, somewhat equivalent to sign flag of Intel. Zero flag, Z is zero flag, C is carry flag, and V is the overflow flag. So C is carry flag will set when there is a carry from the MSB of the result. Zero flag will be set when there is when the arithmetic and logical operation results in zero. N flag will be set when the number is a negative or positive signed number. Now V flag will be set when the results overflows, or when the number overflows, then this flag will be set. Now you can see here, as I said, these are called as a condition flags. Based on the condition flags, various conditional instructions will be executed, like example, branch if carry, branch if no carry, branch if zero, branch if no zero, something like that. Various conditional instruction will be executed. So as I said, N is a will be activated when negative results from ALU. 0 will be activated when the 0 results from ALU. C will be activated when there is a carry. V will be activated when there is an overflow. And other than that, we have two more flags. That is, one is called Q, ALU operation. When the ALU operation is saturated, this flag will be activated. And J. J flag will be activated when processor in a condition where it will execute Java bytecode. That condition is called as a ZAZL. So that condition is called as a ZAZL. So students, you can see here, when J bit is activated, then the processor is said to be ZAZL enabled processor, which execute 8-bit instruction, which execute a 8-bit instruction. Now students, you will see one by one a conditional flag. So as I told, there are four important condition flags: negative, equivalent to sign flag, zero, carry, and overflow. First we will see what is the overflow flag. So let me explain this one with the example. So overflow flag activate when there is a overflow in the addition or result or ALU result. For example, if you take 8 bit number, the range of the 8 bit number is something like minus 80H 2 plus 7FH in hexadecimal. This is the range of 8-bit number, signed number. This is the range of 8-bit signed number. when any number results, or if the result of arithmetic and logical operation results in any number which is in the out of range of this number, then overflow flag will activate. For example, we will take the number now. Like, I want to add two numbers, 40 and 42. So we know when you add two numbers, the answer is two positive number, answer will be positive. So let me write these two numbers in binary form. So when you add this one, so you we know 0, 0, 0, this is 1, this is 0, this is 0, this is 0, this is 0. So this is 1, 1, 0 and carry 1. Now here you see, the most significant bit is 1. So here the in this result, the MSB is 1. This indicates the number is negative. But according to this one, the two, when you add two positive numbers, the result cannot be negative. That indicates this results in overflow. This results in a overflow, because you can see plus 82 cannot come in this range. The plus 82 will come out of this range. That time overflow flag will be set to 1. So one more thing you have to remember here. Along with the overflow flag, I want to tell you one more thing. So we have one more flag, that is negative flag. Negative flag indicator, sign flag. So you have to remember here, my dear student. So when overflow is equal to 0, when there is no overflow, then negative flag is 0. That means the number is actually positive. When there is an overflow, then you have to take then sign flag or negative flag is the complement of sign bit. Here sign bit is 1. So this becomes 0. So you have to remember, when there is no overflow, negative flag will be 0. When there is an overflow, then negative flag will be the complement of this one, sign bit. This one you have to remember. Now, other than this one, so we will move to the other section. Other section is like control field. Control field contains high hefty. High means normal interrupt request, F means fast interrupt request. I told in my previous video, there are two types of interrupt request. Operating mode also. Based on the interrupt request, particular operating mode will be activated. One is IRQ. One is IRQ, that is normal interrupt request. The second one is a fast interrupt request. I told you the difference between a normal interrupt and fast interrupt. Why FIQ is faster? Because FIQ has got 5 new set of register, so that when program jump to FIQ ISR, it need not to save the content of the register in stack. But whereas in IRQ, when the program jump to IRQ ISR, it has to store the content of all the register in stack. That is the difference between IRQ and FIQ. So FIQ has got 5 new sets of register. That's why it's faster compared to IRQ. Then we have, and one more thing you have to remember, my dear student here. Let me take you to the next page. So IRQ and FIQ, if both are 1, then this means the interrupt is disabled. The interrupt is disabled. If both are one, then the interrupt is disabled. And you should know both interrupts are maskable. Both interrupts are maskable. That means you can disable this interrupt, making IRQ and FIQ one. Why? FIQ is one. And one more thing is, during the booting of the your ARM processor, both interrupts will get disabled because on reset, both interrupts will be disabled because your ARM 7 or ARM processor on reset, it goes to booting mode. In booting mode, it has to execute various BIOS program. So during this execution, it doesn't want any type of interrupt. That's why during the booting, both IRQ and FIQ are set it to one. That means both interrupts are disabled. That is the one thing. Next, the next bit is T. T indicates thumb state. Now, our ARM processor. ARM processor supports two mode. ARM processor supports two mode of instruction. One is called as a normal mode, where it makes use of 32-bit instruction. Second one is a thumb mode, where it makes use of 16-bit instructions. So normal mode, it makes use of 32-bit instruction, and these instructions are very powerful because it has got many features. But thumb mode instructions are not much powerful, but it can execute many tasks. Then what are the, why it is called thumb mode? Because these instructions are like miniature version of the normal mode instruction. It is a miniature version of the normal mode instruction. These instructions are smaller in size. That's why it is called as a thumb mode. Something like thumbnail, thumb mode. So, thumb mode instructions. What is the advantage of this thumb mode instructions? See, student, in every device need not to have many devices need not to have powerful. For example, if you are using some remote control, when you design a remote control, the cost is very important, the size of the remote control is very important, the power saving of the remote control is important. Rather than you need not to run Windows on the remote control, or you need not to worry about the performance of the remote control. In such a case, such type of design, I am giving analogy, such type of design, we are using thumb mode instruction. So let me tell you the advantage of thumb mode. Now, in normal mode, all the instructions are 4 bytes. Just like imagine you have 1 KB memory means 1024 bytes. So 1024 bytes, and if you are going to store 4 byte instruction, it can store around 256 instructions. Suppose instead of this one, if you use thumb mode, in thumb mode each instruction size is 2 bytes or 16 bit, you can store 512 instruction. So in 1 KB you can store 512 instruction. This means code density will increase here. And actually when you see this one, you need less memory if you use to store more code if you use thumb instruction. When you say you are using less memory, or memory size is small, then circuit size is small, then cost of the circuit is small, and major point is power consumption of the circuit is small or very less, That is very, very, very important from the design of embedded system, or you can say that from the perspective point of embedded system, power consumption is a very important criteria. So in such a case, we are going to use thumb mode instruction or 16-bit instruction. That is the one thing. So if t is equal to 0, on reset, t becomes thumb, t bit becomes 0 here. If t becomes 1, it will move from normal state to thumb state. Here you can see so let me erase this one. Here you can see this is thumb, t bit. When t bit is 0, it will be in the normal mode. When t bit is 1, it will move to the thumb mode. So 1 means it will move to thumb mode, 0 means it will be in the normal mode or ARM mode or 32-bit instruction. Similarly, you can see I and F, when I, F and both are 1, it is disabled. So now we will move to the last 4 bits here. This 5 bits, these 5 bits are used for the, to set the processor mode. We know ARM7 operates in 7 different modes. ARM7 operates in 7 different operating modes. In my previous video, I have told like what are the different modes of ARM7. Let me recall that one. The first mode is like supervisor mode. When you reboot your ARM7 processor, first it will go to supervisor mode. During the booting stage, it will go to supervisor mode. The other than that supervisor mode, we have something called user mode. And if you want to execute system function, you can call system mode. Then for IRQ, normal interrupt mode, FIQ, fast interrupt mode. Then we have something called as undefined mode and abort mode. So undefined and abort, both are error mode. So there are 7 operating mode. So this mode bits indicates in which operating mode your processor is. For example, if this bit is 1000, that indicates the processor is in the user mode. So let me zoom this one bit. Here you can see, when the bit pattern is 1000, so when the bit pattern is 1000, it is in user mode. When the bit pattern is 111, it is in system mode. When bit pattern is 1001, it is in FIQ mode. When the bit pattern is 10010, it is in IRQ mode. When the bit pattern is 10011, it is in supervisor mode. When bit pattern is 10111, it is in abort mode. When bit pattern is 1101, it is in undefined mode. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These are the 7 modes. So this mode bit indicates in each operating mode your processor is in. So this is the use of this mode. So student, I have explained you current program status register. Same things applies for saved program status register, SPSR. Same things applies for SPSR. Why? Because SPSR makes the copy of a CPSR. Whatever there in the CPSR will be copied to SPSR. So same theory will hold good for SPSR. So CPSR contain 4 section. One is a flag, second one is processor mode, third one is about state of the processor, like whether it's ARM mode or thumb mode, then about interrupt. So all this information is given to you now. Thank you for your cooperation. Thank you.